to dekhoge whether it affects the poorest of the poor or not. This is what he said. Then the student said, sir, we don't work for poor here. This is, we are doing at that time cosmic ray physics. कि कॉस्मिक रे फिजिक्स में पुअर का चक्कर कुछ नहीं है, वो नहीं है कोई. उनका नहीं नहीं ऐसा कुछ तो होगा. उनका नहीं सर. तो गांधी ने कहा, लेकिन पैसा आपको कौन देता है? गरीब लोग तो पैसा दिया ना आपको. तो वो स्टूडेंट बोला, नहीं नहीं ये तो टाटा कंपनी दिया पैसा. गांधी अगेन रिटॉर्टेड कि टाटा कंपनी भी तो लोग से लेके देता है, गरीब से लिया होगा कहीं से तो, बाय सेलिंग हिज सॉल्ट और वॉट एवर यंस मनी. सो द स्टूडेंट्स कुडंट सैटिस्फाई हिम. The faculty also kept quiet. How to relate cosmic ray physics with the requirements of the ordinary people? Today your ISRO scientists can say, you know, we provide the satellite and the data and, you know, monsoon data, so we serve you, ordinary people, or education and satellites, etc. But that time they couldn't. So, but Gandhi's question was definitely valid. By asking this question, Gandhi introduced the notion of what you call social accountability. Social accountability. This is where I end, saying that science is socially accountable. Science, medicine, technology, whatever we do, it is not a ivory tower work. A scientist shouldn't claim saying that you won't understand my language. Deepak Kumar, you are a historian, I have nothing to do with you because you won't understand it is a technical language which I use, and I am a nuclear physicist, my language you won't understand. And whatever I want, you just give me and forget it. I want this much millions of grant, you give me. And don't ask me questions. This he can do. I can appreciate his requirement. I have a right as a citizen to know what is being done in Bark or elsewhere or anywhere. I have a right to know. Every individual has a right to know how knowledge is moving, where knowledge is moving, for whom knowledge is moving. Why, how, and whom? These are very important questions. And all these require reply, require redressal. To seek answers to these questions, we can go back to the past, learn from them, and it will definitely provide us with some understanding. Probably a better understanding. I'm grateful for your patient hearing. I hope I made some sense. Forgive me for my extempore and moving around from here and there. But my paper, which is a very brief one, has already been put on the website, which is supposed to be my formal address. Forgive me for being informal with you, but I hope I made sense and I'm grateful. Thank you very much. Namaskar.
I agree with you that there are not many questions asked. But that doesn't mean our society is speechless. You ask them to talk on six pay commission, reduction in fees, celebrating your Shinga-like festivals, and you know how much they talk, all chaotic and nonsensical. But when it will come to knowledge, when it will come to the true sciences, they are speechless. That's a fact. What she said also, I fully agree that our schools are anytime better. While discussing this issue with many other exchange programs, we found that our schools, Dr. Agarkar is sitting here, he knows that our schools are definitely better. Let's not criticize them unnecessarily. Our school education, our students and our teachers are doing best with available resources and many other things. However, I again fully agree with you, Deepak Kumar, that our colleges have become a center of fun and wasting time. Again, it is free, practically it is free. And poor graduation also is, we have to improve a lot. Well, friends, I would start with your last, it's a very important speech, and I hope all of you sitting here would go through the internets and libraries and see that he has talked on various very fundamental and basic issues which have been discussed all over the world in the field of history of science, philosophy, and education, all three. I will start with the last reference of Gandhiji. And here I would say there are two icons or two very important personalities which has been, they represent a very peculiar philosophy, that's Mahatma Gandhi and Jawaharlal Nehru. Mahatma Gandhi, as you said, was he had a kind of he was not at all pro industrialization and many other, anyway, he was very honest. There was no dishonesty in that. His Hindu Swarajya or all his writings, he has very clearly, very powerfully has given his logical conclusions for that. However, so-called his political heir was Jawaharlal Nehru. He was diagonally opposite to him. And I would request all of you, because this is a dialogue which is a very classical, very typical, maybe a perennial, for years and centuries it will go on, about that modernity and tradition. You see in 1945, from 44 onwards to 45, 46, you read in Young India, and there is some exchange between Nehru and Gandhiji. I tell you that those letters of Gandhiji and the Nehru should be, they are available, but unfortunately they are not, politicians don't find much favor with them, because there is a tough fight amongst both these two great leaders. And that fight is on some basic issues, what India needs, what after independence we have to give to the society. And they touch to the absolutely core of education, core of philosophy, core of economics and everything. So, from that I would go to your first beginning, what you started. And you said that science is not neutral, value neutral. And I agree, I fully agree with you. Though I was not agreeing that earlier, when I started my study of history of science, I thought science is universal, but which is not. And once you make science universal, that makes you opaque to earlier civilizations, that you don't understand, you don't agree that there was something, some people were originally thinking, there was some better dialogue or so many other things have happened. You see, another example we usually give is the period of infancy. That earlier period was a period of infancy. You see, anthropomorphic model is imposed there, and once we talk about infancy, we talk about a child, and child is not can conceive the better responsibilities, better ideas. So the whole idea of that anthropomorphic model of having an intellectual ability like a child goes to the civilization. You see, civilization earlier period is a period of infancy, and then adulthood, and then maturity. So while talking about the history of science, once you accept that the earlier period is a period of infancy, there itself we become opaque to the achievements of earlier, and there is no question that we have to accept that a kind of defeat, that nothing earlier could have been happened worth mentioning. Question is not whether it is a microscope, or question is not whether it is a jet plane, or question is not whether it is a computer. Question is much beyond that, the originality, which touches to the normal human nature, which you have been talking again and again, that whether can science deliver that? And that problem, if you want to solve, then really you have to first understand the basic assumption that science is not universal. Science is culture, you see, it is all rooted in culture. And once you accept that it is rooted in culture, then you understand the epistemology of science. I'll go to the next problem then. If you don't, you agree that science is not universal, science is related to culture and society, science is related, then your epistemology changes. You talk about a revolution, and the scientific revolution starts with Copernican revolution. In the science books it is written that it is a Copernican revolution. What that revolution is? There is no war there. Nothing was, there was no bloodshed that way in the science from that point. But what is the Copernican revolution? Copernican revolution was against the religious thoughts then. He put forward a heliocentric view which was not acceptable to Ptolemy. It was not acceptable to Babel. He revolutionized that thinking, which was a geocentric view. He made it a heliocentric view. I will come to the history of science then. And it is very recently, in 1960s, 1970s, and in the 1990s, it was American professors, those who found some manuscripts in Beirut. You know Dr. Kennedy, Edward Kennedy, who was a head of that American Institute of in Beirut, who got these manuscripts, and he transported them to Nijabur. And Nijabur of Brown University was shocked to see that what Copernicus required two theorems,
to prove his heliocentric view. They are not original. They were non-Greek. He has used that. They were non-Greek. And from where they came? They came from the Arabic science of 12th century. So it was a plagiarism. Copernicus was not original. It is known now for last 30 years, but your knowledge books, your encyclopedias, your history books, they don't mention that. Now, here is the problem. Here comes the speciousness. If you don't read, if you don't read the books, if you don't go to internet, if you don't interact, then you will not understand that. And then you won't actually ascertain your identity. We talk a lot about the colonial period, gone 60 years. You said rightly that it was like that then, and it is also now today. So very little has changed. Our minds have not yet been decolonized. And if you want to do that, then you will have to study more. You will have to ask more questions. And without studying, you cannot ask questions. Relevant questions here, I mean. So friends, the whole idea of keeping these lectures, you know, this is the fifth lecture. You see, from Dr. Phatak till today, the whole idea of keeping these lectures, we want people, those who have contributed specially to that particular branch of knowledge. Such people want to pick them up from the whole India and if required abroad also and bring it to you, expose them to you, their thinking, so that we start some new thinking. I am sure Dr. Deepak Kumar's speech today will create some curiosity in you. You will start reading those important topics. Let me tell you, these are the subjects what he has taught are the topics which every scientist, every great scholar in the world is discussing, writing in books. And if you go to the forums, internet forums, you will find that these are the subjects, whether it be colonialism or other subjects, they are discussed maximum. And there are very few Indians there. Maybe even knowing Mr. C.K. Raju, I find him only fighting there in the mathematics forum and physics forum about Indianness and Indian contribution in mathematics. Well, friends, I don't want to take much of your time. Yes, word of thanks, Naik, you would be proposing with these few words. On my part, I thank you and thank all of you. Thank